Hi, I'm Chef Costa Magoulas. On this episode of Local Flavor, we're serving up fantastic Florida citrus and fresh from the garden vegetables. So you got to make sure you stay tuned for another episode of Local Flavor. Welcome again to Local Flavor. On tonight's menu, orange honey glazed pork chops, straight from the farm. And for our vegetarian friends that have been fussing out there, we also we're preparing a marinated roasted vegetable antipasto. Oh boy, that sounds good. Now before we get started cooking, let me introduce our guest for this evening, fourth generation produce grower, Steve Crump. Welcome to the show, Steve.
Thanks, Costas, it's nice to be here today.
You know, I just can't get over how long your family's been in this business, four generations.
We came in the 1880s from Illinois. We've been in Volusia County ever since, but we still have the original farm back in Illinois.
Oh my God, what's the name of the farm?
Vo-Lasalle Farms, the Vo for Volusia County and the LaSalle for LaSalle County, Illinois.
That's amazing. Well, I want to remind everybody, this is a call-in show. 1-800-901-9238. We want to hear from you, so call in about vegetables, produce. We're going to do a lot of things tonight, so don't forget to give us a good call. So, Steve, tell us a little bit about your farm. We want to take a little short drive down there, so it's in Ponce de Leon, right?
It's in De Leon Springs. And, you know, our farm specializes in citrus and in vegetables.
That's amazing.
We do our vegetables a little different. We do them hydroponically. We grow them in a pot on a tower, and it helps keep the vegetable clean. We use a little less insecticides this way.
Boy, that looks really clean. It really does.
We work real hard at doing that. It's also a you-pick farm, so our customers come out and pick their own produce. And some things we grow outside, kale, collards, Brussels sprouts.
How big is that area there?
It's going to be about 1 acre of hydroponic vegetables. The difference is with hydroponic, and we're all growing them on towers, we have many more plants per acre than if you grew them in a row on the field because we're going vertically in the air.
So how big is the whole farm, though?
Well, the whole farm is about 150 acres, and we only have 1 acre in vegetables, 65 in citrus, and the rest is in cattle and timber.
So weather, I guess, affects your growing, different things that you grow there, I would imagine.
Well, in Florida is a winter vegetable state. We grow most of our vegetables in the wintertime, and we concentrate on doing it very well. So winter cold weather is our biggest problem, and we like to grow things in a greenhouse. Tomatoes, peppers, cucumbers, we grow them in a greenhouse so we can protect them from the cold.
Now you grow a lot of different kinds of citrus, I see.
Yeah, we grow citrus. We start harvesting in October, and we'll have different varieties that we harvest all the way until May.
Oh, so you have it year round almost.
Well, about 7 months out of the year, yes.
Boy, they look beautiful too. Wow.
Well, thanks, those are.
And we have some here too at the show we're gonna show everyone. Mm-hmm. That's amazing. I just can't get over the... Oh, what is that?
Those are our pomelo grapefruit. Those are huge. They're a little smaller than a volleyball, but it's a very popular item with Asian and Caribbean island folks.
Now, what are they doing here?
Well, after we harvest the fruit, we have to wash it. They dip it in a water bath, and then it goes up a little elevator, and a set of brushes and fresh water brush the dirt and the mildew that might be on the fruit, brush it off, and clean it up.
That just clean water?
That's just clean water that is being sprayed on it, just to loosen the dirt that's on the fruit. And then
you
when it gets done, it comes out.
Talking about how old that was.
That machine is older than you and I combined. It really is that old.
Well, we're back here at the studio, folks. Don't forget, our number is 1-800-901-9238. You can tell us it's a live show. I'm sitting here, you know, with a lozenger going, oops. Don't forget, 1-800-901-9238. Well, we're going to get started cooking here, okay? And I'm going to look at that pork that you brought in, that pork chop.
Yeah,
and they're just gorgeous. I'm going to put them out here. I had them marinating in a brine, and the brine I use is brown sugar. I've talked about this before. It's brown sugar and salt. Man, look at these pork chops. Don't they look beautiful? Where did this pork come from?
You know, Costa, this I bought at the Volusia County Fair. We bought the whole hog at the fair, and we bought it at an auction at the fair. They sell about 150 a year, along with steers and lamb. And it's a real good way to get meat for the family, or in our case, a couple of families. We could share it.
Yeah, I could tell. You know, when we were talking earlier about beef as well, that's a lot too much meat for one family, right?
It often is. A whole steer is too much for one family. But what we've done in the past is we'll go in with another family and buy half a piece, or we can even give it to our employees as a Christmas gift. Instead of a bonus, they might get 100 pounds of beef, and they're just as happy with that.
I bet they are. Now, I'm going to season this slightly with this mix I have here. I like to use this. This is smoked salt, pepper, and garlic. And I'm going to put some of this. I can't hurt that, right?
No, it's going to be fantastic. It's going to look good.
Can you smell that?
Oh, yeah.
Isn't that nice?
Yeah. Yes.
People tease me about that all the time. Now, I'm using my whoop-de-doo cooker here, this induction stove, and it's getting hot pretty quick. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take these pork chops that you brought in. I said, looks so good. Look at that meat. Golly. Look at that thing. Isn't that gorgeous?
Well, that was local grown right here in Volusia County by the 4-H kids, the youth.
I love it. I love it. I'm going to put this out of the way. Don't forget, folks, our number is 1-800-901-9238. So give us a call. Ask us questions about whatever we're doing here tonight. And Steve, I got to ask you about some of the things you do out there. We were talking about the citrus that you have and everything, and that you had beekeepers come out.
Beekeepers come out during the orange blossom season, and they'll put their beehives out to collect orange blossom honey.
Now, our buddy was here not too long ago from Orange Blossom. You
know? Yeah. Well, it's a great service for us. We get the pollination service. The beekeeper gets the honey. So both of us get benefit from it.
So there's not a fee for that or anything?
No, they don't charge us for it. Now, they will charge some produce growers for pollination service, but they get enough honey from the orange blossom that they'll do it for free.
You know, you were telling me something about that I thought was kind of funny. You said something about the bees and coming out there, and you had bears?
Well, sometimes I'll tell the beekeeper, don't come to this location this year. There's a family of bears there. There'll be a problem. They're going to tear the hives up.
Well, we have a call on the line. We have Barbara from Alpaca. Hey, Barbara. Oops, we just lost her. Call back, Barbara. Anyway, we were talking about the bears. I just can't get over that.
Yeah, they can be a real nuisance, especially to a beehive.
And they actually tear it up?
They'll destroy it overnight, and we've had them do it, and I've called the beekeeper and, hey, come get your hives. The bear tore up two last night, and he'll get two more tonight. So the beekeepers are very quick about coming out there if there's bears.
You know, I got to tell you, this is smelling good already.
Yeah, it looks great.
We got another call on the line. We got Gene from Deltona. What's going on, Gene?
Hi.
Well,
not much is going on. I'm actually doing holiday baking.
Good.
But my question is, at the farm, are they able to grow artichokes in Florida?
Artichokes? I have not yet tried to grow an artichoke.
Well, that's one of my favorites,
is
too,
it? You know, now the way we decide what we're going to grow is people ask us to grow stuff. When they ask us to grow it, we figure out how to do it. This is our first year growing Brussels sprouts. We're still learning how to do it.
Brussels sprouts are good. You know, there's a simple recipe for Brussels sprouts. You cut a little X in them, and you put them in a saute pan with some almonds or walnuts and a little butter, and that's it.
And that's it.
Cook them. Oh, man, are they good. I'm searing this on one side, and I'm going to get it. Look at that. Oh, boy.
Now, how hot are you cooking that? Would this be medium on my stove? Or?
It's about medium on your stove. Sauté is considered high heat on a sauté pan. But I don't like to get it too high because I'm afraid it might burn it before it really gets done. So medium heat's really the best way to go. Okay, we got Barbara from Palatka?
No,
Apopka. Okay, Barbara.
Near Orlando.
Nero, yes, ma'am, I'm very familiar with it. What's your question for us?
I would need to know where you are. We would love to see this place.
Oh, our farm is located in DeLeon Springs.
Where is that?
That is north of DeLand in Volusia County.
I see.
And off US Highway 17. The easiest way is to look us up on Google. and give us a call, and we'll give you directions to come find us. We are not very easy to find, though.
Is that right? Because yeah. I was thinking from where she's at, you might, I can't remember, is it 40 or 44 that you have to come down, catch 1792?
Yeah, there's a couple different ways out of Apopka, but it, you know, if you look it on the internet, it'd be the easiest.
If you check our Facebook page, you'll be able to get the information from that. So, we got another call from South Daytona. Mitch from South Daytona, how you doing?
Good, Chef. My question's for the farmer.
Yes, sir. What's up? Steve, it's for you.
Yes, I would like to know what kind of irrigation he uses out there for his hydroponics. If it's like a slow drip, or does he use a sprinkler system?
Okay, irrigation on the hydroponics. This is very low tech. We use a dripper that is a 8 liters per hour pressure compensated dripper. I buy them locally in Pearson, Florida, and it's very simple to install. This is something that they use on pots to grow landscape plants. We find it works real well for us.
Really?
Yeah. The water and fertilizer drips in the top pot, and it drips through the tower and out the bottom.
We have another call on the line. Boy, they're just ringing off the hook here. Kay from Edgewater. What's your question, Kay? Okay, caller, Kay from Edgewater.
Hi.
Hi.
I like to make homemade garlic oil. And someone told me that if I make it, it can grow bacteria. And I was wondering, if I do make it, how would I store it, refrigerated or unrefrigerated?
I didn't catch what you were trying to grow.
Homemade garlic oil.
Homemade garlic oil.
Homemade garlic oil. Yeah, you got to be careful with garlic oil. It's something that has to be refrigerated once you make it, okay? It can get botulism, and that's not real good. A lot of people, what they do is they use citrus, vitamin C as a preventative, and that kind of preserves it a little bit. But my suggestion for garlic oil, anytime you make it, you should keep it refrigerated. And this is coming off. Wow, what do you think of this?
Oh, they look great. They cook fast. That's a fast meal right there.
Yeah, it doesn't take too long.
Yeah.
Let me put this back over here. Now, what I want to do is clean this up a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Ah. Yeah, we're going to look at the recipe on this. And it's coming up. It's orange glazed Florida pork chop. You take a tablespoon of honey, orange juice, Dijon mustard, light soy sauce, and ground pepper and everything. You saw me do that. So what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to take, kind of clean this pan up just a shade, and I'm going to put the orange juice in here. Turn this down and put some more butter. Woo! It's all that fat-free butter. Everybody teases me about that. Oh, man, look at that. Now, what I'm going to do is I have these fresh oranges that I squeezed that you brought in.
Right.
I have soy sauce in here. And I have that Dijon mustard. And we're going to kind of cook it down and let it cook for a few minutes. And then we're going to put that glaze right over the pork chops. We have another call on the line. We got Phil from Volusia County. Good. Phil,
Hello.
What's your question for us?
What kind of heirloom tomatoes do we grow?
What kind of tomatoes? That's a good
heirloom
question.
Heirloom tomatoes. Well, we've got three different kinds of heirlooms we grow on the farm. I've got a wild cherry tomato, which is a small little black tomato. We grow the Cherokee purple heirloom tomato, which this is about how they look. Cracked, discolored on top. We also grow another one called a black creme, which looks very similar to the Cherokee purple. It's hard to tell them apart. And I also grow the Tasty Lee, which is a hybrid tomato.
That's my favorite right there in your hand. I just love that.
Oh, it's a great tasting tomato. It's a very difficult tomato to grow.
Is it really?
It is. It's prone to a lot of diseases.
We have another call on the line already. We've got Brett from Winter Park. Hey, Brett.
Yes, Chef, this question's for the gardener.
Yes, sir.
I wanted to know, in the summertime, it is so hot in Florida, what vegetables does he grow in the garden during the summer?
Oh, that's an easy answer to that one. We close in the months of June, July, August, and September. So we don't grow anything in our garden during the summer. If you wanted to try something, okra does well, Costas. Black-eyed peas, conch peas, the southern peas will do well in the summertime. You could also get by possibly with something like watermelons, but that's really about it.
Well, that's good to know. I grow stuff at home. I do herbs and things, right. But my wife, oh boy, that's a different story. If she touches it, I love her to death, but they die. So they have no chance. As soon as I get home, I'm going to hear about
You'll
it.
You'll hear you know, about it. Yeah, yeah. Well, that's all right.
It's pretty neat. I love herbs, fresh herbs. You grow fresh herbs,
We
too.
Do grow fresh herbs. It's not a big part of our business, but because we do a lot of cooks that come out there, that they're wanting to pick their own vegetables, we have a supply of herbs. And we grow about 7 different herbs at any given time.
I tell you what, using fresh, it's just nothing like it.
Well, that's what they tell us. And we really enjoy it when I eat it. In my family, in my household, we notice the difference, but I'm not a real good chef like you. So I'm really looking forward to what you're doing tonight.
Well, herbs, now when we use fresh herbs, you have to use 3 to 1. If a recipe calls for 1 teaspoon of dry herbs, you use 3 teaspoons of the fresh. It doesn't have the oils that are the artificial oils, so it's not as strong, but you get all that fresh flavor
fresh
out of
flavor.
It.
Oh, yeah.
It's just fantastic. Well, this thing is coming along pretty good. We're going to be done here. What kind of herbs do you grow, come to think of it?
Well, we have rosemary, basil, oregano, thyme, sage, and I think that's all that are available today at this time.
So there's seasons on that as well.
There's seasons on that. Basil does okay up until it gets really cold and it does not like it at all. But there's seasons on all the herbs.
Yeah, I had
and
2 beautiful
them.
Basil plants and they're gone.
They're gone. But anytime it gets below 50, they go quick.
Okay, we're getting ready to get this cooked down a little bit. We have another phone call.
Okay.
Esther from DeLeon Springs.
Oh, very good.
What's your question for us?
Hi, my question is, how do they make fresh squeezed orange juice? And do you ever serve it at the Cafe 101?
No, ma'am, we don't. There's a process, just for a second.
Yeah.
Orange juice, you can't squeeze orange juice in your restaurant just to squeeze oranges. It's really, they're very protective of that. And there is a health requirement. You have to really set up what they call a HACCP plan in your restaurant to do that. And certain restaurants, they have a machine that they, there's a couple restaurants in town that do that, but you probably know more about
well,
that.
Well, we make fresh orange juice.
You do, yeah.
But we can't sell it to the restaurant trade.
See,
we have to sell it retail right there at the store, direct to the customer. And we make orange juice starting in November, and we make it through May, and it depends on the varieties that are ripe at the time, what we blend and make our
I know they're real strict about the...
They are very strict. We get inspected by the state.
Yeah, you sure do.
Yes, we do.
I'm going to go ahead and put... We have another call on the line. Hang on a second, please. Paul from Apaca, are you there?
Yes, I am.
How about your question for us, Paul?
My question is for the farmer. How early does he put out, start his tomato plant? I mean, out the garden from after it's been, the small plants are started.
Well, our tomato season, we plant the seeds in July. The third week of July, we plant the seeds in a tray. The seeds will grow in the tray for about 6 weeks, and then we'll transplant them into the garden. Usually around the first week of September, the transplants go in. We start picking tomatoes 60 to 70 days after that. We'll get the first tomatoes.
Want to try that pork?
Sure.
We're going to put that right here so everybody can see that.
Mmm.
That tastes...
I can taste the citrus in it.
Yeah, you can.
Mm-hmm.
You really can. That citrus, I think... You know, people don't understand citrus actually acts like a salt. It brings flavor up in foods, and it's quite a lemon, but orange I love especially. I do salmon at home from my mother-in-law. She loves it.
Right.
So what I do is I marinate it in that orange juice, a little bit of soy, and then I roast it in the oven with fresh vegetables and fresh fruit. She just gets a kick out of that. We're going to get started on another project here. Okay. Now, what we're going to do next is vegetables, and that's what I wanted to talk about. Before I get started, look at this. You believe this is celery, guys.
Well, that's celery straight out of the field, and I cut that 2 hours ago before I came to the show.
I saw that, I couldn't believe it. I said, I love it. You talk about fresh.
Yeah, and it's the whole celery stalk, leaves and all, right?
See, you people have never seen this, okay? This is first time on TV, right?
Right. So usually you get just the heart, just the center, but this is the whole thing, and it's all edible.
And that's outside, nice. They can come to your farm and do this.
They can cut they have to cut their own.
We're going to look at some more here.
Yeah.
What we're going to do, I'm going to get started real quick doing a few vegetables. So I'm going to pull some of this over here.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to put these over here and... Steve, pardon me.
What do you need?
I'm going to get a few of these right here.
All right.
So we can talk about this. This is what I like right here.
Well, this is our romaine lettuce, and lettuce is one of our specialties out there. It's very easy to grow in the wintertime in Florida. Most people think of lettuce as being very cold sensitive, but it's not. Lettuce is cold hardy. It'll grow through the frost, below freezing temperatures. It doesn't bother it.
But you know what I get a kick out of? People put this in salads, right?
Right.
We cook it. We actually cook it like a green.
Wilt it down? And
boil it down, and then we'll add olive oil to it and lemon and salt and pepper. It's fantastic.
Yeah.
But now you showed me this different type of lettuce right here.
Well, that's a bib lettuce. So this is a real soft lettuce, and the texture is what's different. Very tender, very soft. I like it in salads, not so much on a sandwich. It doesn't feel right on a sandwich to me.
Yeah, it's too soft
for a sandwich. It's too soft for a sandwich. I like something a little snap or a little crunch. Maybe a romaine or a green crisp.
Yeah, you said you grew different lettuce. How many different styles of lettuce?
We have three different styles of lettuce that we consistently grow. A romaine, a bib, and then a summer crisp, which is a loose leaf green lettuce.
Now, folks, while I'm talking to Steve about this, I'm cutting up these vegetables. And if you want to take a little closer shot of that, I'm cutting them up into little chunks, you know, big size. And I'm going to do that with everything here. Except for the asparagus. I'm just going to break these off right there. So they break off down at the bottom. They're going to be tender. Now, here's the thing. What you could do is you take a potato peeler and you peel the outer skin off here, and then you can use that in soups and everything so you don't waste it.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, go to a restaurant, and if you did that to the chef, he'd throw you out of the kitchen.
Yeah.
He'd say, what are you doing with
You're
those
wasting,
things?
Wasting my food.
That's right. But anyway, so you were taught, this is what I wanted you to show her, but I saw this thing, I said, what is that?
This is our cauliflower. This variety is called cheddar, because it looks like a big head of cheddar cheese. But it's a very popular variety we grow now. We also grow one called snow, which is a white cauliflower, a more standard looking cauliflower.
Well, I'm gonna throw this on here real quick, because I wanna show people what's gonna happen here. The magic oven's gonna get cooking.
Yeah.
And that's one thing about peppers. People don't realize how to cut a pepper. Here's a pepper. Most people cut it in half. All I do is work around it like this and just keep turning the pepper, and there's your pepper.
Beautiful.
Isn't that nice? And there's nothing in there. You just cut it up.
No seeds to just pick out. Oh.
You don't even have to pick out seeds because the seeds
are
in here.
They're all inside.
And then you cut the end off. A lot of people go, wow, that's pretty neat the way you do that.
That's pretty neat.
Now, what I'm going to do to mayor, and I also use eggplant. I don't take the skin off. I leave the skin on. I'm going to put that in our antipasto. And I'm going to put all this stuff aside for the time being. Now, all you do is take olive oil and put that in. Take balsamic vinegar or regular vinegar that you like.
Mm-hmm.
Mix that in here.
I like the way you measure.
And then you just put your marinade and you put it together and you put it over here in the magic oven. And here's your antipasto already cooked. And that's what it looks like when it's roasted in the oven. And that looked beautiful.
That's beautiful, yeah.
And then you top it with feta cheese, olives, and you're pretty much it. You know, Steve, I really want to... The recipe card's going to be coming up on this. Steve, I really want to thank you for coming down.
Well, you're welcome. It was a pleasure to be
here. Recipe card, we're looking at eggplant, zucchini. Here's the thing about this roasted antipasto. Any vegetables in season really work for you. They're listed here that I used tonight, but I minced them all together. And then what I'm going to do is top it. Look at that.
Do you serve as hot or cold?
Serve it either way. Oh. Instead of taking a cold dish or hot dish, you can serve this hot or cold. And it's pretty nice. It's different.
It's different.
Now, wow. This is... Steve, do you want to say anything to us before you leave here tonight?
Hey, I've enjoyed being here. I'd like to eat local and eat healthy and eat well, right?
Great. Well, we're out of time. We want to thank everybody, and I want to thank you, Steve, for coming down and showing us all these vegetables. I'm excited. Those heirloom tomatoes, I can't wait. Be sure to check out our Facebook page for all the recipes featured on this show, and feel free to email. We got a bunch of them last week with your questions or comments. Thank you for joining us tonight on Local Flavor.